Okay, so as I said, I have no format, no slides, no nothing. This is going to be a dialogue. Any question and any problem that you want me to solve or any other thing that you want to ask, you're welcome. It's an open house. So let's start with any problem, any programming question where you have had difficulties or any concept in which you have had difficulties.
Bolo. How to read a CSV file, okay.
So a CSV file is actually a comma separated value file, as we call it, and it is nothing but a text file. It's a file with plain text. So you can directly open it using gedit, or you can directly read into a program using your getLine function. So if you have an array or a string, you just say getLine and that entire string, one line, will come. So there is no difference. If you have a problem, you should rename it as a txt file, because some programs may not recognize .csv extension as text. So that's not a problem at all. But I thought the file which was given, the sample file which was given, was a txt file, right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So I have not done anything. I have not converted a CSV file into this or something. I simply renamed it as .txt.
So but in that, there are commas and different spaces. So how to read means? As in, if such
an
array is given,
he is being smart. He is asking me to solve the assignment problem so that he can submit it. that is not fair, because the assignment deadline is actually being extended. Today morning I had talked to some students who had come, your team leaders for the project. And I have said that while there will be no more assignments in this course, this particular, assignment also is extended. All assignments you can resubmit if you want to, up to the end of the coming week. So even if you have submitted earlier some assignment which was not correct or which you wanted to improve, you can actually resubmit all those assignments over the next week. So since this assignment technically is an individual evaluation, I would not like to specifically comment on the issues related to that assignment. But I can help you out in finding out how you can gloss over, let us say, spaces. It's just spaces here or spaces there. Or how do you detect a comma? Now that's a generic problem. So since comma is part of the assignment, I will not take comma. I will say, let's consider full stop, any other punctuation mark. So if I have a string, how do I detect a punctuation mark? Okay, that's a problem, right? Basically, it is the simpler version of that problem is, given a string, how do I detect any existing punctuation mark in that array, in that string? Okay. So I think I have, this I was planning to discuss with you when the assignment time was over. I had constructed deliberately a program . Is this a correct problem statement? How to locate a particular symbol? So let's say there is a symbol which is some character, we don't know which one, and let's say there is some array called, let's call it, string is a reserved word. So let's use some other this thing. Line is also actually reserved. I don't like it. Okay, let's simply call it L for line. Okay, so L, whatever. Now, as you know, these string arrays are null terminated. So which means if I have a string here, let's assume this L contains so it contains H O W one blank, A R E one blank, Y O U one question mark, three blanks, and F I N E fine, full stop. This is what is there in that array. Okay. Now how will these symbols be inside this? You know, for example, that L 0 will be actually containing H. L1 will contain O, small o. L2 will contain W. And just to get to the blank, L3 will contain a space. So let's say we are interested in identifying space and locating full stop, locating question mark. These are the punctuation symbols. Let's assume that for some reason we want to finally get a string which just contains we'll call it a result string. In the worst case, the result string will be as large as the input string. So we'll call this R256, another string which I am declaring. And I want R to contain effectively the following: H O W A R E Y O U F I N E. That's all. I want this string to be inside this R. So what I want to do, I want to remove all the blanks, all the question mark, all the full stops, and I just want to compress it into this. Is that a fair approximation of the problem that you're facing? Okay. Now you know that the way the strings are contained inside, if this is the string, then actually the last element at the end of this will be a backslash n. Are you familiar with this? The null terminated string. So I shall have this symbol at the end somewhere. Okay. Similarly, if this is going to be the string, then this will be 0th element, 1st element, 2nd element, etc., 3rd, 4th, 5th, 6th, 7th, 8th, 9th, 10th, 11th, 12th, and the 13th element will be backslash n. It should be. Otherwise, C++ in an array will not recognize a proper string. A string is terminated by backslash zero, null terminated string. You did not correct me. It should be backslash zero. It's actually zero value, null. Okay. Did we discuss this or not in the class? Character string in a single array, or we have not discussed? The last lecture, null terminated string, did I mention? Yes, so you are familiar with this representative. Okay, we will worry about how do we get such a string inside this L. Now for that there is a function called getLine. So you can get the entire line which you type. Ordinarily, if you type something like this, then the cin will simply forget this. It will just take HOW as the first string and give it to the whatever you have named as variable, string variable. If you want the whole line, you have to say getLine. Okay. Because cin is not really dealing with a complete string of so and so length. It is actually dealing with individual values. That is how you input numbers separated by blank and so on. But we will say that we have got this string in L and now we want the result string in R like this. So basically, how do I move all the blanks, full stops? In the process, commas are also covered, right? So you can actually rewrite that thing to handle commas. First, we will solve a simpler problem of locating a symbol inside the array, where it is. Okay. So, this program code, this is not part of the larger problem, this is just a sample example. So, now the symbol is a single char, if you recall, we have declared symbol to be a single character value. So this is not a string, by the way. This is not an array. It can hold just one character. So you must understand the difference. If I have an array and if I want it to contain string which C++ can understand, then that must be a null terminated string. Whereas if there is a single character, that single character will be just in a single quote mark, I can write whatever symbol. So consider I want to detect the presence of a question mark. So I will say this is a valid assignment. So question mark symbol, a question mark is assigned to symbol variable. So in that location for symbol there will be a question mark. Okay. Now I have to go over this array L. So I'll declare some index, let us say I, and I want to locate the position of this symbol if I find one. So I will declare another variable, let us say pos, to indicate the position of the symbol in that array. Okay. Effectively, what do I have to do? Let me break my program and get some space on the right hand side. So this is my array L. And the 0th element contains what? Capital H. The first element contains O. Second element contains W. Third element contains blank, etc. And which element contains question mark? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. So 12th element contains question mark. 13th element is blank. 14th element is blank. Sorry? 11th, is it? Oh, that is because 0th contains H. I am sorry. So 11th contains question mark and this will be blank. Fine. So basically, whatever program segment I write, the value of POS should be 11 at the end, if it contains. Now, how do I detect this? Very simple. It is just like you search for a numerical value inside an array. And how many elements do you search for? As many as there are there in this array before backslash zero. Somewhere it will be backslash zero. We don't know what that position is because the string is unknown to us. But we know maximum value is how much? 255. Actually, there are 256 elements. So 255th element is the last element in that array. So somewhere before 255, I must find this. Actually, if I don't find a backslash zero, then the array does not contain the proper character string as per C++. Okay. Ordinarily, what I would say for, I want to go for I equal to 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, like this. So naturally, I want to start with I equal to 0. I want to go maximum up to what point? 255. So I would like to say I plus plus. That is my last thing. Now what should be the condition? Without even thinking, we can write down this loop, because my array size is 256, first element is 0, last element is 255, and I have to go through all the elements one by one. So let us first write a simple loop like this and try to locate a symbol here. Now, how will I check this? If, what am I comparing? Any element of array L, so if Li equals symbol. See, it's as simple as that. I am trying to locate a symbol, question mark. If Li is equal to symbol, then I have to do something and get out. If Li is not equal to symbol, then I have to increment I and go back. So if Li is equal to symbol, this is the position where symbol I have found. So I will say pos is equal to I. That means I have found it here. So when I goes through 1, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4 like this, here I detect it, I put this value into pos. That's my position. But after finding out, I don't want to continue the iteration. That will be stupid. Then I will go here and again check. This will not be question mark. In fact, there is likely to be only one question mark. So I'll unnecessarily go further. I don't want to go anymore. I want to stop. What is the statement to get out of any iteration? Break. So I will say break. And that is the end of this if. If the symbol is not found at the ith position, say 0th or 1st, what do I want to do? Nothing. Simply go back and check the next position. So that means I go to the next iteration. Right? So if there is a symbol, then this iteration when I come out, pos will have the value I. However, there is also a problem. Suppose I cheat and I don't put any question mark in the string, then what will this iteration do? It will never meet the if condition, because there is no question mark in the whole string. So I'll go, if I equal to 0, is it symbol? No. I equal to 1? No. 2, 3, 4. I will cross over till I becomes less than or equal to 55, I'll continue. When I becomes 256, what will happen? I'll come out of the loop. So I will come out of this iteration for one of the two reasons. One, when I have found a symbol, or second, when the symbol does not exist. But I have an indication. What is that indication? When I come out of the iteration, when I is equal to 256, because I would have been incremented. Remember, when will this loop normally end? When I becomes greater than 255. So if I is 256, I have not found the symbol. If I is less than 256, that means I have come out of the iteration for a reason other than this. Remember, even if the question mark is in the last position, when I is equal to 255, this if statement will work out to be true. So L255 will be equal to symbol. In which case, I will not only set pos equal to I, but I would have broken out. That means the iteration does not get a chance to increment I. So therefore, even last element is question mark, the value of pos will be 255, and the value of I will also be 255. I would not have been incremented. So a simple Dumbo thing to do is, if I is equal to 256, see out, no question mark, else see out, question mark at Okay, if you want, you can put it like this. Just to be technically correct, I am trying to preserve space here. Is this understood? What is the logic? So there are two learnings from this. First of all, even if I have set up a loop, I cannot blindly assume that there is a question mark and I will find it. I have to still check whether I have found it or not. There is another simpler method, however, which does not depend upon the index, and that is the value of pos itself. So the other alternative that I have is to set pos equal to, say, some negative value, minus 1. Now I know that before starting my iteration, I can now check for pos. If pos is negative, that means it is the value which I had artificially given to pos originally, but my loop has not found pos. Why? Because if this loop had found the position, it would have been one of the values 0 to 255. So that means it would have been a positive value. And therefore, if pos is positive, I have found it. If pos is negative, I have not found it. Now, you change the symbol to anything else. Change the symbol to space, it will locate space. Once you have the position, and you can have pos 1, pos 2, pos 3, as many positions as you want, you can actually locate positions of various symbols. So this is the way you go over a single dimensional array of character string to locate any individual symbol. Now let us come to the main problem. We'll go back to page 1 again here. Our original problem, we said that if we have a string which is spread out like this, ordinary sentence that we'll write, somebody has written 3 blanks here. For some reason, I want to compress all characters. So data compression, the size of the memory will reduce. Actually, nothing reduces because I have already declared array L to be 256. The array does not shrink, but only the string gets compressed. I want to compress it like this. So what would be the strategy now? Can you figure out what is the strategy? The strategy for solving this problem will be that I have, let's draw this array L horizontally. So I have H, O, W, blank, R, blank, U, blank, question mark, and then I have 3 blanks here. And then I have, let's say, fine, full stop, and backslash 0. This is my string. So this is my string L. What I want in R, I want H, I want O, I want W. So that means this goes here, this goes here, this goes here. But when I notice a blank, the blank should not go into the result string. Okay, so blank doesn't go anywhere. I have to ignore blank. I have to jump over blank. Now A goes to the next position. So A goes here, R goes here, E goes here. Is that correct? Now I want to gloss over this blank. So now Y goes here, and so on. So notice that this was 0th position, 1st position, 2nd position, 3rd position, 4th, 5th, 6th, 7th, 8th. But in this array, I will have this as 0, 1, 2, this will be 3, 4, 5, this will be 6. So what was in the 8th position should go to 6th position. What was in the 4th position should go to 3rd position. Likewise, this is how the compression will happen. It is obvious, therefore, that nothing will be served if I simply copy one by one every character here blindly. So what I have to do is, I have to have 2 different indices. Let us say one index is I for this array L, and another index J for this array R. And these two will not move in the same fashion. They will never have the same value after some time. Initially, both of them will start with zero. So J is the target index, I is the source index. The source index should move from 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, etc. up to 255. But this index should move only when some element gets inside. If no element gets inside this array, J remains wherever. So if I have 20 blanks at the beginning, okay, I will move from 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 19 and will become 20. But J will remain 0. Well, I have not put anything in this. You get this logic? So let us now try to write a program segment which will transfer the array elements of L into array elements of R one at a time, provided that element is not any one of question mark, full stop or blank, right? We may want to identify the length of the string which is inside a particular thing. How do you identify the length of the string inside an array? Simple. You keep searching the array elements till you find a backslash 0. When you find a backslash 0, that position is the last position. So before that, all are characters. If the backslash 0 position is found at POS, let us say, so all that we do is, if symbol is set to backslash 0, POS is the length. Is that correct? Suppose symbol backslash 0 in the array in our previous program. If symbol is backslash 0, then in this case, backslash 0 will be which position you had found out. What was the position of backslash 0? I can't count. Anybody has counted? 19. Remember, you are starting with 0. The index is 19. No, there is a full stop. So 19 will be full stop and 20 will be this. Okay. Now, this is very interesting. If 20th element is backslash 0, the length of the string is also 20 because we start with 0. So if you count the number of characters in this string, okay, this is 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 up to 19 means there are 20 symbols. So only one advantage of this stupid way of array counting, array indexing in C++, which starts from 0, is that when you hit the backslash 0, the value of the position is actually length of the string. So imagine now, therefore, that we had put symbol as backslash 0 in our symbol location thing, then POS would be the length of that. It is better to capture that separately in another variable. We will call it length L equal to POS. Assuming that we have found out the position, length L is now length of that string inside that array. What is the advantage? Now I don't have to blindly search, okay, till 255 if the total string size is 255. Okay. So in fact, there is a function in C library which can determine this length automatically. If you give that function the parameter which is the string array, it will return the length. But here we have done some godagiri and found out the length. Let us. Now I want to transfer from L to R. So how will I transfer from L to R? I have to go over the string L. Well, let's again look back at what we decided to do. This is our logic. I'll go back to slide 3. The first character goes to first position, I mean 0th position, first goes to first, second goes to second. Third one is a blank, we have to move over it. Seventh one is a blank, we have to move over it. We copy 8th, 9th, 10th. 11th is a question mark, we have to move over it. 12th is a blank, we have to move over it. That is how we will get a compressed. But essentially, it is obvious that as far as the first string is concerned, I have to go over the entire array element by element, starting from 0 up to length. So, as long as the index is less than length, I have to traverse there. At length position, I know it is backslash 0, so there is no point in looking at the array subsequent. Consequently, the iteration that I will have to set up, the controlling iteration for this transfer, will be set up in terms of the string from which I have to copy. Is this clear? What is there at length L? There is backslash 0. But when I transfer a string, the string in R should be a valid string. That means it should also have a backslash 0 at the end. Now, why separately put a separate statement to assign that last position with backslash 0 when I got a ready-made backslash 0 in this string? So, I simply copy that to the last backslash 0 also. I know that I am going to gloss over things, but I am going to miss out on only blanks and question marks and so on. Since backslash 0 is readily available, if I say this, then this will mean that I am going to move my index I from 0 up to and including the length. That means up to and including the backslash 0, which I actually want. I want to copy that backslash. It's your choice. You can either run the iteration up to less than this thing, and then at the end, in the final position of array R, you can actually insert a backslash 0. Or since backslash 0 is available here, I can copy it here. Now what I have to do, if I have to check L I, what? If li is equal to comma, I don't have to copy. If li is equal to blank, not copy. If li is equal to question mark, not copy. That means if it is not equal to, I have to copy. So if li not equal to question mark, how do I write or vertical bars? If li not equal to blank or, no, is it or is it and? Because if I say or, so if it is neither this, it will still be true. So, what was it? Full stop we wanted to skip, right? You will notice that it doesn't matter which symbol you want to skip. Any symbol you want to skip, you write here. If the ith element of L is not any one of the wanted symbols, then you want to copy it. Where do you want to copy it? You want to copy this into some element of R. What is that element? We said that element will be J. But wait, where is J defined? Now this is cross-check you should automatically do, your mind should automatically do. Whenever you are writing an index for any array, J, K, Z, POS, whatever, immediately go back few lines and see whether that value is defined. For example, when I wrote LI, it was fresh in my mind that I am setting value of I. So valid value is set. But when I write J, okay, my ear should start tweaking. Did I define J? I find no, I have not defined it. Suppose J is minus 304. Then the first element H will go into operating system memory and my program will crash. What should I do therefore? I should set J equal to because this is the first element. Now I know J is set, but J is preferable not to use the looping structure to modify value of J, although I can. Why? Because J is not synchronously moving with I. I is moving 1, 1, 2, 3, 4, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. J we don't know. So J is separately maintained. So I will set Rj is equal to Li. You agree that ith element will now get transferred to jth element of R. Now, I want to increment I, increment J also. But I is going to be incremented by my for iteration. So I will just change J. If statement has ended, I have nothing else to do. If the array element is any one of these, I don't want to copy it. If I don't want to copy it, that means when I simply move I to the next value, I plus plus, I have jumped over that element. So if there is one blank, I would jump over it. Next time again I get another blank, it will catch it here. I simply put this. Once again, you made me convert OR to AND. Please examine whether this is correct. So let us consider what this condition means in terms of some actual value. On slide 2, we had written down, this is the string. What is L0? Capital H. So let us apply this condition that we have written on L0. L0 is actually having a value capital H. Let us see what happens to this if condition. Is L0 not equal to question mark? Yes, it is not equal. So this is true. Is L0 not equal to blank? Yes, this is true. Is L0 not equal to full stop? This is true. All three conditions are true. Therefore, this total condition is true, and I will come out in here, assign this value, increase J plus, exactly as I desire. Consider now some other element, which is here. It is L3, which is blank. So I compare this. Is L1 not equal to question mark? True. Is L1 not equal to question mark, blank? False. Because this is blank. Is L3, sorry, not L1, L3, L3, and is L3 not equal to full stop? True. So this is not equal to full stop, this is not equal to question mark, but this is equal to blank. That means this condition is false, this condition is true, this condition is true. Any true and false is false. Therefore, this entire complex condition is false. When I come out here, this statement will not be executed. This statement will not be executed. I will come out simply, increase I and go back. You agree that I will have now finally the string that I desire? This is the way I can compress, depress, whatever. Now, you can take as home exercise in a small tweaking of this code. For example, I could have written J equal to 0 here itself. It is perfectly valid to say and then do exactly what you did. What am I doing? I know that I have to start looking at both the arrays, transferring values, but the second array index, I'm going to maintain myself, but I have to initialize it. So I might as well initialize it along with the initialization of I. Observe that unless I put something about J here, J will not change automatically. The only thing that changes is the third specification of for state. And I have said I plus plus, so J will not change. But J will change because I am going to change it in my iteration. So this saves me one separate instruction of setting j equal to 0. I would like you to consider, is there any alternative to write this kind of complex thing? Well, you will have to check this, but there is another variation of if statement in C++ called switch. We will not discuss that switch. Try to examine what that switch does. More importantly, there is a function built into the C string library which can automatically locate if any character is a punctuation mark. Punctuation mark includes full stop, comma, question mark, exclamation mark. Does it include blank? Perhaps not. Examine that. Compare it, check it whether it works. These are all tweakings. This algorithm will work guaranteed, no issue. Doesn't matter which compiler you run it on. But if you use functions, you may make your life simpler. In this particular case, you did not use a function because this comparison is simple. But if you have to write 20 lines of code to determine whether a symbol is there or not, then you might as well consider writing a small function yourself. Let us, for example, write down if any symbol that is given to me is full stop, comma, question mark, blank, or any punctuation mark or blank. Let me write a function. What will happen? Instead of writing this complicated condition, which may become longer and longer if I have more symbols to move over. For example, if my problem, so this is one solution. The second point that I'm mentioning is, I want to check and ignore question mark, full stop, comma, blank, exclamation mark, double apostrophe, single apostrophe, anything else that you can think of? Colon, semicolon. Ye sab lafda nahi chahiye. Any one of them exists in the string, I want to ignore and push only the remaining string. Now, imagine if your program was written like that, ye Hanuman ki pooj jaisa, it will, that if statement will become long and long and long. Okay. Now, suppose I decide that instead of doing this ghodagiri in my main program, and I have to do this with many strings, I will rather write a function. That function should return a truth value, yes or no, true or false. And it should return a value, let's say true, if the character that I send it has any one of these. And if that character which I send it is not any one of these, it should return false. So I write a function, bool function. I want to return it a boolean value, true or false. Okay. And the function name, let us is I call it special char. That means this function I am writing to determine if a character given to me is a special character or not. If it is not a special character, then I will say not special char. That means the function should return false. But if the given character is one of the special characters, then I should say true, it is a special character. That is the function I want to write. So what shall be the parameter inside? It should be a char. Let's call it char x. So I'm writing a function whose parameter is a character x. And what I have to do now? I have to just check whether it is one of those characters. Abhi yahan I can write a Hanuman ki poonch very simply. If char equal question mark or, this time or, right? Because, sorry, yeah. Sorry? Oh, x, oh, I'm sorry, good. If x equal question mark, then I want to return true. Or, if it is x equal full stop, I want to return this. Or, if x equal comma, okay, or if x equal space, or x equal, you see, till I get thoroughly bored with life, I have to keep writing this, or x equal double quote. There is going to be fun here. Double quote will work correctly. Now, or x equal single quote. Is this correct? What it will do is it will take the first single quote, the second single quote, and it will assume I am comparing it with null. Because this is a character. Anything enclosed in single quote is a character. Nothing enclosed in a single quote is nothing character, which is null. Okay. I will leave this as homework. How do you handle this? That's why I deliberately, when somebody suggested other symbols, I added a single quote also. However, let's assume we are not checking for single quote now. That is simpler. So, we remove this. But there are other fellows. Who are the other fellows? Colon, semicolon, or x equal colon, or x equal semicolon. If x is any one of these, then what I want to say, yes, you send me a special character. What is going to be the return value? Is a truth value. So I can simply say, if this is so, return what? Else, brother, I am done. Sorry?
We have to define true and false.
You have to define?
True and false.
No. True and false are constants. They are like 1, 2, 3, 4, 27, 35. So C++ recognizes true as the truth value. And it recognizes false as false value. Since C++ inherits these bool type from C, a zero value is treated as false, and any positive value is treated as plus, as true. So it is not uncommon to find some people saying return 1, else return 0. Because 0 is treated as false. But technically you should not do that. 0 and 1 are integer values. So if you declare this as int, and you should correctly check for an integer numeric value in your main function, then it is okay. But please note that we are writing a function to tell us a decision. True or false decision. It is only proper to declare that function to return a value of the Boolean type. So this is the Boolean function. And what I will return will be either true or false value. So true and false are not variables or anything. They are actually constants. They are like, as I said, symbol 1, 2, 3, 4 value. They're constant value. And they are known to C++ compile. So this will compile correctly, this will also work correctly. So do you agree that this ghodagiri that I would have otherwise done in my main program is best done separately in a function called special char? Okay. Now, let us go back to our program. I have this program here. I want to rewrite this program using this function call. So let me rewrite this program. This is the segment. I keep this segment in front of me and I'm going to rewrite this segment. You can read this part. All that I now need to do is, I will say, for I equal to 0, comma, j equal to 0, semicolon, I goes all the way up to and including length of L, and I increment I plus plus. And what do I do inside this? If I am going to call which function? And what is the parameter I am going to pass? Sorry. All that I am saying is, please go to that function which I wrote called special char with the value li. If li is special char, then what will it return? It will return as true. If it is a special char, what do I want to do? Nothing. I just want to increment I plus. But if it is not a special char, what do I want to do? Transfer them. So if not special char, this function special char will return true if it is a special char. I want to find out when that returns false. Then only I want to transfer. So if not special char, so if special char returns false, then not special char will be true. And I can now transfer values. As I said, that's it. Please note that your program becomes smaller, it also becomes neater, and it also becomes more understandable, because anybody else reading this program will notice what you are trying to do here is, you want to ignore some special character. The reader may not understand which special characters you are ignoring, but it will be immediately understood that this is a function call, because there is a bracket, there is a parameter, bracket close. So this is not a standard command, so this is a function call. Now any function call can either be a standard function in C++ or a function written by you. Since any reader will recognize this is not a standard function, therefore he'll go back and see whether there is a function that you have written, and yes, in your file somewhere. And remember, when you do large projects, this function may not even be in your file. It may be somewhere else. Just like C functions that you use, C++ functions that you use, you don't write them. Somebody else has written them, right? So those functions come from some other files which are called header files. In a large project, such functions which you have written could also be compiled separately by you. The point is that any reader of this program can easily see that there is a function reference being made. One character value is going back, and what is coming back is obviously a Boolean value, because I am checking whether the return value is true or false. Is this understood? Or there is a problem in understanding this? Yes or no? Okay, fine. Yeah.
We are making J++. Is this a loop for J?
No, this is not a loop for J. This is a loop for I.
Then how J will increase?
I am increasing J. Loop is not increasing J. I am increasing J. Let us again look at that array. Yes, I really wanted these kind of questions to be asked. Let's go over this. What we said is that I am setting up an iteration for I equal to 0 to I equal to 255. Or I equal to length. So I will increase automatically. But remember, what is my purpose? My purpose is to transfer this string into J. So let me take, on the 7th slide, I will write the following. This is my array L, okay? And I want to transfer from array L to array result. Within the same loop, as I moves from 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, I want j to move from 0, 1, 2, but I don't want this third element to go to third element here. But I want j to change. Now please note that I is changing linearly, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 up to length. So therefore I can write in the loop condition for I equal to 0 or something. But if I put j also in the loop, then it will change also linearly. I don't want that. So I am changing j myself. It is not necessary to go over an array that you must write an iteration. I could write the Ghodagri of saying R0 equal to this, R1 equal to this, R2 equal to this myself. Instead, I have a statement which says Rj equal to something. But having assigned a value, I must change j. So j is changing within the loop, but not automatically. I am changing it. And how am I changing it? Whenever I move from this to this, so j will get h here by the first transfer. I will change, I will execute j plus plus. That means j will become 1 now. I am executing j plus plus. I am giving it a command. Loop is not changing it. So j will become 1. Now I get O. When I is equal to 0, I equal to 1, this 1 I will get O here. When I becomes 2, I will get W here and I will change this to 3. Now I is 3 here. Notice, I will detect this is special character. This is not to be transferred here. I will change from 3 to 4, but J will remain wherever it. Why? Because loop is not changing j, I am changing. Now when the fourth element is a, how are you? When a comes here, a will now come inside here. Why? Because I had changed to 4, but j has remained at 3. That is what I want.
Sir, one more thing, we can write a loop for j also. J equal to 0, j less than I, j plus, less than equal to I.
What will it achieve? Why do I have to loop? Because I don't have to go back into J. A loop within a loop will execute n square times. It will be long to put a loop within a loop because it is unnecessary. Please note that in this logic, when I go I equal to 0, 1, 2, 3, 4 up to this, I would have not only completely scanned this array, मैंने ये पूरी array देख ली होगी उस समय और उसी समय में मैंने ये array भर दी होगी तो मुझे दूसरे loop की जरूरत ही नहीं. इनफैक्ट अगर मैंने दूसरा loop लिखा तो गलत हो जाएगा क्योंकि J हर बार I की कोई एक वैल्यू होगी वो J फिर जीरो से शुरू करेगा. मैं जब यहाँ तक पहुँच चुका हूँ और मैंने ये W यहाँ पर डाल दिया है तो अभी मुझे J इक्वल टू जीरो देखने की जरूरत ही नहीं है क्योंकि यहाँ पर मैं भर चुका हूँ उस array में. So in fact, J should never move back. So therefore, I should never have an array loop within J equal to 0 to something. That is because if there is a loop, the loop can either be standalone or it can be inside another loop. Agar maine for I equal to 0 likha hai, aur uske niche kahin bhi main for J equal to 0 likhta hu, to I ki har value ke liye wo pura loop J equal to 0 se chalu hoga. Kya hum wo chahte hai? Nahin chahte. To isliye J ke liye loop likhna bekar hai. मतलब एक्चुअली गलत है. जब हम क्या चाहते हैं कि एक बार इस आरे को हम स्कैन करें और करते करते एलिमेंट बटोरते रहें, जो काम के उनको यहाँ रख दें, जो काम के नहीं उन्हें भूल जाए. तो हमें पूरा एग्जीक्यूशन खाली एन टाइम्स करना है, एन स्क्वेयर टाइम नहीं करना. जब एन स्क्वेयर टाइम करना हो या तो टू डायमेंशनल आरे हो या हर एलिमेंट के आरे के पहले आरे के एक एलिमेंट के लिए मुझे दूसरे के पूरे एलिमेंट्स देखना हो, वो कब संभव है? जब आर एक कोई दूसरा आ रहे है उसमें कोई पूरा एक स्ट्रिंग रखा हुआ है. वैसा भी हम प्रॉब्लम देखेंगे कि जहां जे को लूप लिखना पड़ेगा हमें. सो लेट अस टेक एन एग्जांपल वेयर आई विल रिक्वायर ए लूप विद इन ए लूप. बट एज फार एज दिस प्रॉब्लम इज कंसर्न, इट इज रॉन्ग टू पुट द सेकेंड बिकॉज इन वन शॉट आई वॉन्ट टू फिनिश ऑफ एवरीथिंग. इज दिस क्लियर? राइट. या
the first case, when we were locating the position of the question mark,
yes,
if there are multiple question marks, rather than breaking, how do you detect that? Because we are getting out of the loop.
In the first case, I will be getting out of the loop. But in the second case, when I am transferring, I will not forget that. If I get the next fellow's question mark, it will also ignore that. So let us distinguish between the two programs. The very first program you are referring to, right? Find the question mark. This was a problem which says how to locate a particular symbol in any array of character. If you want to locate multiple occurrences of that symbol in a string, you will have to simply run a loop, and for every position you have to output that position. So you run a loop here, instead of saying pos equal to I, you will have to output that pos, or you have to store it in some array, some other numerical array, that first position this, second position this, third position this, and continue this loop. There is no break here. But you will have to locate this position separately. You can't keep saying pos equal to I every time, because at the end there will be only one pos. So if you want to identify different positions, it's a good question. I may give it in the end sem, but you people know this question.
Sir, we are applying break, so it will break the if loop.
It will break. No, there is no if loop. Please remember, if is not a loop. If is a single occurrence, it will just test this, and yes or no, it will do either this or that. If is not a loop. Break will break a loop, the nearest loop. The nearest loop is for. Is a acha sawal pucha ye break. Break does not break anything in if. If breaks automatically when I put this. There is nothing to break. If is, if this condition, then do this, else do this. If ka kaam khatam ho gaya waise bhi. Ye break hai jo ye for loop ko break kar dega.
So is it necessary to apply it in if iteration or we can apply it outside?
You can apply anywhere. Anywhere where break comes, the for iteration, next iteration will go. But I don't want this particular iteration to do anything else after I have located it. Mujhe isse koi kaam dham nahi hai ki aage aur kya kar raha hai ye for iteration. Kuch bhi kar raha hu main use keh raha hu kaam band karo wapas jao next take next time. So break if it comes anywhere in the iteration, the rest of the iteration is skipped completely. Is break ka khali itna matlab hai ki ye for loop ka agar ye closing brass yahan par hai to yahan pe aa jao. That's all it means. तो इसके बीच में मैंने 500 स्टेटमेंट भी लिखे होंगे तो भी मैं वहीं पे जाऊंगा. ब्रेक का मतलब ये. सो लेट अस सॉल्व टू प्रॉब्लम्स. वन प्रॉब्लम इज फाइंडिंग आउट मल्टीपल अकरेंसेस ऑफ ए पर्टिकुलर सिंबल. हाउ डू आई फाइंड मल्टीपल अकरेंसेस एंड वेयर दे आर? बिकॉज मल्टीपल अकरेंसेस, एक तो बोलते हैं कि खाली काउंट करेंगे मल्टीपल अकरेंसेस. काउंटिंग इज सिंपल. सो हाउ मेनी क्वेश्चन मार्क्स आर देयर इन ए स्ट्रिंग और हाउ मेनी ब्लैंक्स आर देयर इन ए स्ट्रिंग, हाउ विल आई काउंट? You said question mark, but I'll take it as blank. Any symbol is okay. How do I count multiple instances of any particular symbol in a string? So we go back to our first program that we write to locate one particular symbol, one question mark we had said. We'll use the same thing to find out the number of instances. Here I will declare int I, which is my index to go over the array, and I will declare a variable called count, which will count the number of instances. I will declare a symbol as a single character, and I will declare an array L of two 256 elements.
Symbol and
L is
character, so why?
Oh, I'm sorry. Very good. So int I count char symbol comma L256. I assume that array L has been read, whatever, get line or some function. Now I want to find out multiple occurrences. Since to begin with, I have to assume that the symbol does not occur at all. So I will initialize the symbol to blank. And I will set count equal to 0, because I have not found any symbol. So counting is actually very simple. I will just say for I equal to 0, I less than well, if the array contains a character string, the last element has to be backslash null. The last element cannot be a special symbol. Nahi to array nahi hogi. But if you want, whatever, I mean, it's up to you. Ordinarily, I would like to actually go up to the length of the string. So ordinarily, you should always determine the length of the string and limit your scan to that length of the string. Okay. So that you can do, but the point I am trying to make here is, I really don't need much. What I need inside this is, if any element of L is a symbol, I should increment the count. No else statement required, nothing required. I am just looking at every element of the array. If that element of the array is equal to symbol, count ko ek se bada diya. Count was 0. If I have one blank, it will become 1. If a blank is there in 5th position, it will become 1 more. If blank is 13th position, it will become 1 more, and so on. At the end, when I come out, I simply say print sorry. The array element is incrementing automatically because of the for loop. So, kya karega? 0th element dekhega, 1st dekhega, 2nd dekhega, 5th element blank hai, to ek add kar dega, to count will become 1 here. 6th, 7th, 13th element blank hai, to count ko ek aur badhayega, count 2 ho jayega. Remember, count started from 0. Now, count is incrementing every time there is a blank. At the end, whatever is the value of count, that will say so many blanks are there. Is that okay? This is the easiest way to count all the number of blanks or any special symbol that you want. The harder problem is, I want to locate the positions of blanks anywhere. So individual position mujhe dekhna. I will give you an array. मान लीजिए ये मेरी स्ट्रिंग है, दिस इज माय एल स्ट्रिंग एल, सपोज दिस इज माय आरे. अभी देखिए इस आरे में 0th एलिमेंट में एच है, 1st एलिमेंट में ओ है, 2nd एलिमेंट में डब्ल्यू है, 3rd एलिमेंट में ब्लैंक है, ये मुझे चाहिए. ये 4th एलिमेंट है, 5th है, 6th है, ये 7th एलिमेंट है, ये मुझे लोकेट करना है. 8th एलिमेंट है, आई हैव टू लोकेट. 9th एलिमेंट है, आई हैव टू लोकेट. ये 10th है, 11th है, 12th है, 13th है, और इसके आगे एक्चुअली एक बैकस्लैश 0 होगा बिकॉज इट्स ए कैरेक्टर स्ट्रिंग. तो ये मेरी स्ट्रिंग है. अभी नाउ माय प्रॉब्लम इज नॉट टू काउंट ब्लैंक्स. इफ आई वांट टू काउंट ब्लैंक, काउंट विल बिकम 4. दिस इज फर्स्ट काउंट, सेकंड, थर्ड, फोर्थ. तो इफ आई रन द प्रीवियस प्रोग्राम विथ सिंबल एज ब्लैंक, आई विल गेट काउंट इक्वल टू 4. करेक्ट आंसर. Now what I want to know is that blank is occurring at what positions. So I want position, first position is 3, second position is 7, third position is 8, fourth position is 9. If I want to count how many blanks, which positions blank occurs, I am not going to expect only one answer. I am going to get multiple answers. And I don't want to just print them. Printing is very easy. What can I do? Instead of saying count plus plus, if I say C out count plus plus, observe that C out count plus plus will increment the count and print it also. Should I say C out count plus plus or should I say C out plus plus count? Oh, C out I, okay. Sorry. C out I. I is the position. Count is only the number. So if I just want to indicate, print the position, then I can say C out I will get the position printed. But that position will be on the paper. Suppose in my program, later on I want to do something with these positions. Is position mein mujhe star dalna hai. Is position mein kuch karna hai. Ya is position se aage tak kuch aur karna hai. I want these positions stored. Now multiple positions agar hain, so I can't store them in a single variable. Either I will have multiple variables. So the question is that if I want to locate multiple positions of the blank, then I can't just print them. I have to put them somewhere. And I can't put them in variables. How many variables will I write? I don't know. There are 5 positions, 10 positions, 20. It depends on how many places. So again, I will actually put that into an array. So this time I will declare POS as an array and then keep putting a value in POS which is actually the position of the array. How do I know how many positions are there? That means how many blanks are there? So I will have a simple variable which will count the number of blanks and the value of that is the maximum number of distinct values assembled in the array. So consequently, if I have an array, POS, in this particular example, POS 0 will contain this, POS 1 will contain this, 2 will contain this, 3 will contain this. And the total number of entries into this array are 4. Okay. So I will say number of blanks, n blank, should be equal to 4 at the end. This is the count, or blank count, or whatever variable. Now my job is, given this string L, I have to scan L and assemble these positions into this array called POS. So consequently, my data structure will slightly change. I will have, of course, int I, where I is the, what should I say, index variable for scanning L. I will have n blank, which is my count for number of blanks in the array POS. I will have POS, which is also an array of integer because I am going to put positions inside it. How many elements should POS have? As many as there are blanks. How many blanks can be there? Well, it depends upon who gives me input. Ordinarily, I am going to run this program to read character strings. So, 255 line character ka agar string hai, I will expect 10, 15, 20 blanks. But suppose there is a sadist who actually gives you a blank line only, 255 blanks, karo count. That is the worst case, no? So worst case ke liye isko bhi 255 bana dete. I don't need 256, by the way. I don't need 256 because there is no backslash 0. This is not a character string array. This is an integer array. I am going to locate positions here. So I, n blank, POS 255, my character as usual will be L 256. Since the element inside POS will have to be indexed by some other thing than I am going to attach I to L. In fact, it is a good programming practice that you associate with one array, one index. doesn't matter if you have multiple names. That way there will be never any confusion. So instead of reusing index I for this array, that array, whatever, whatever, there is no harm. So you can declare this to be int IL. That means OL array case abstract. For this, I could have used J, but remember we used J some time ago to go over another character string. So let me use here another integer variable called kPos. So k is an index variable which will vary over the array pos. So ye pos hai, ye jo value hai yahan par, this I am calling kPos, my own symbol. You agree that it is easier to associate an index with an array if the name is similar. I will never make a mistake. I will never say LKPOS or I will never say PKPOS in the search. I can of course use it anywhere, but I am saying that I will use it inside this. Now I have to determine the positions and put them here. You will agree that the basic loop structure will be same. I will have to say for now what I am saying, if now I have to do something more. If I have found a symbol, then symbol is at ith position. So I have to put this value of I into this place. Remember, in this array, this statement would have been true only when I is not 0, 1, 2, but when I is equal to 3. And I want to capture 3 and put it in the first position of this array. Okay. But what is the first position? Later on, I will have to put this 7 into second position, which is 1. So that means I will have to maintain kPos independently as a separate variable. So it is only proper that I start with kPos equal to 0 somewhere before my iteration begins. Ye kPos yahan pe initialize ho gaya 0. Now, if I find a symbol, what do I have to do? I have to say kPos plus plus, yane isme kuch dalna, sorry, not. I have to actually capture I. So what should I say? Pos kPos equal to I. Yane ye jo position I hai, which is 3, ye maine capture kar li is array ke 0th element. Aur itna karne ke baad I will say kPos plus plus. So abhi kPos 0 tha, usme maine ye value 3 dal di, aur kPos 1 karke main baith gaya hu. Abhi yahan kuch aaya nahi hai. My kPos is 1. Now after this I simply say end of my if, end of my for. Jao wapis agla aay dekho, I will be equal to 4. Is it blank? No. Again agla aay dekho is r, agla aay dekho is e. When I is equal to 6, Li is equal to E. It is not blank. So I will keep moving up and up and up. When I becomes 7, I get trapped into this if, because L7 is blank. When L7 is blank, I will say pos kPos equal to I. Remember, kPos is 1. So first element jo hai pos ka, not 0th element. First element mein I ki value chali jayegi, jo 7. Aur iske baad kPos badke 2 ho jayega. Better rahega yahan par. You will agree that when I finish this iteration, I would have captured all the positions of blank in this array. And what would have been my kPos at that point? Because kPos is incremented every time I will have found a blank. So I would have, when I insert in the third element the value 9, the value will go correctly in the third element, but kPos will become 4. So So as a result, when I come out of this iteration, whatever is the value of k pos is the number of blanks I have. So consequently, will it not be right for me to say n blank is equal to k pos? How many blanks I have discovered? As many is the value of k pos, because k pos would have been 4. Observe that another sadist gives me an array which has no blank, don't know. I will not find any blank. That means isme kuch entry nahi hogi. Lekin agar kuch entry nahi hui to k pos ki value kya hogi? 0. If k pos is 0, well, this whole iteration will be a futile exercise of moving around in loops and coming with nothing. But my k pos will be 0. So that 0 value will be assigned to n blank. So, baad mein kisi ne pucha, how many value blanks you have? N blank. N blank 0 hai, to 0 hai. 4 hai, to 4 hai, 255 hai, to 250. Is that okay? So, count the number of blanks and indicate the position separately. Ab maan lijiye, we'll come back to that question. Comma separated fields, right? Consider now a string which has comma separated values. So, abhi ek string likhte hain. Do you remember what was the string? There was a serial number, let's say 123, then there was a comma. Then I think there was roll number. So, let us take some sample roll number 07D41003. Then there was a comma, then there was a name. Let me write my name. Actually, I was a student in 69. So let me write 69. I am modern roll number. So 69D41003, Deepak Phatak. And I have, after that, what is the lab batch, right? So let's say lab batch 1D, whatever it is. And then marks. How many marks do you think I'll make? I'll at least get 30 marks. Let's assume. No, no, 45 is difficult. I make lot many errors, as you have seen. My lab TA will cut minus marks for every syntax error I make, and I will get practically not more than 30. But that's okay. It's a sample. Now, the point I'm making is, you want to separate out this field, this field, this field, this field, and this field, right? So, important thing is you want to determine commas in this string. And you want to take out from 0 to first comma, then this comma plus 1 to next comma, then that comma position plus 1 to next comma, then that comma position to plus 1 to next comma, and last field, comma position plus 1 to end of the string. You want to take this fellow out, put it in some string, this fellow out, put it in something else, this fellow out, put it in something else. You want to take substrings out of this string and put them somewhere else. Now you can see how that pos array concept will help. All that I do is that in this program, instead of symbol being blank, I put symbol equal to comma. If I put symbol equal to comma, jahan jahan comma hai uski position pakad mein aa jayegi. Now I want to print. I will show an example, because going any further in this direction is solving the assignment problem for you. But instead, what I will do is, I want to find out the name in this string, which is known to be in the third field, first, second, third field mein naam hai. Mujhe khali naam nikal ke batao. Assume that this string is in L. So L is equal to this entire thing. I have extracted this. Assume that I have found out the position of all commas here. So pos array jo mera rahega, wo kya hoga? Can you tell me what will be the positions? द फर्स्ट कॉमा जीरोएथ जो है वो 0, 1, 2, 3 पे रहेगा, सेकंड कॉमा जो है 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12 पे रहेगा, नो सॉरी 12 फिर। अगला पोजीशन में 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, ओ स्पेस है, सॉरी 19 पे कॉमा नहीं है, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26 बराबर है, वट एवर अप्रोक्सीमेटली बराबर है ये 26। द नेक्स्ट एलिमेंट थर्ड एलिमेंट विल बी 27, 28, 29 एंड देयर इज नो फोर्थ एलिमेंट, बैकस्लैश 0 आ गया। ये मैंने पॉस एरे में पिछले प्रोग्राम से कलेक्ट कर लिया, अब मुझे नाम छापना है तो मैं उसी प्रोग्राम के आखिरी में जाके खाली इतना अगर बोल दूं सी आउट, क्या छापना है मुझे, एक कैरेक्टर छाप रहा हूं। ये आई की वैल्यू क्या है भैया, ये आई की वैल्यू होना चाहिए यहां से लेके यहां तक, ये वैल्यू क्या है, नो नाउ 13 ओके इन एब्सोल्यूट टर्म्स दिस इज 13 एंड व्हाट इज दिस वैल्यू, इंस्टेड ऑफ सेइंग इन एब्सोल्यूट टर्म्स बिकॉज दिस विल वेरी डिपेंडिंग अपॉन, किसी का रोल नंबर गायब है, किसी का सीरियल नंबर गायब है, तो वी डोंट नो व्हाट विल बी द एग्जैक्ट पोजीशन, ऑलवेज इट विल नॉट बी 13। सपोज समबडीज रोल नंबर इज रॉन्गली रिटन एज 3 digit देन दिस विल बी डिफरेंट, suppose somewhere I have not printed this, then this will not be exact. See, this is the point. In a data entry operation, anybody can chew up anything. So you can't guarantee that every name will start from here. Ordinarily it should. Ordinarily every name should start from here. Like in my time, mein, 8 digit ke roll number nahi the. Actually, my roll number kuch to bhi tha, 1742. That's all. अभी ये रोल नंबर दिया तो आपके काउंटिंग का तबला बच जाएगा, सो यू कैंट मेक assumptions अबाउट डेटा, बट वन थिंग इज guaranteed, फील्ड को कॉमा से सेपरेट किया है, वो सीएसवी फाइल है, तो therefore व्हाट आई शुड डू इज आई शुड डिपेंड अपॉन द वैल्यूज इनसाइड हियर। नाउ व्हाट इट मींस इज आई वांट टू रन ए लूप फॉर आई इक्वल टू समथिंग टू I less than something, I plus plus, मैं ये खाली छापना चाहता हूं हर कैरेक्टर, मैं 13वां कैरेक्टर छापना चाहता हूं, 14वां, 15वां, 16वां, 17वां, 18वां, 25वां, 26वां नहीं छापना चाहता और 12 से पहले नहीं छापना चाहता, तो मेरा स्टार्टिंग पॉइंट आय का क्या होगा, पॉस 1 प्लस 1, ये पॉस 1 में 12 है और ये मेरा थर्ड फील्ड है, मेरा फर्स्ट फील्ड जो है वो 0 से चालू होता है पॉस 0 तक जाता है, पॉस 0 माइनस 1, सेकंड फील्ड जो है वो पॉस 0 प्लस 1 से चालू होता है और पॉस 1 माइनस 1 तक जाता है, और मेरा थर्ड फील्ड जो है वो पॉस 1 प्लस 1 से चालू होगा और पॉस 2 माइनस 1 तक जाएगा। सो आई इज इक्वल टू, लेट मी राइट दिस, पॉस वन प्लस वन आई शुड बी लेस देन, लेस देन इक्वल टू कर दिया तो वो कॉमा छप जाएगा, मेरे नाम में कॉमा नहीं है इसलिए वो मत छापो। इतने कैरेक्टर्स आ गए, और बाद में किसी और का नाम मेरे साथ साथ में ना छपे, क्योंकि कोई एक और इंडेक्स होगा कि ऐसे सबके नाम छापो, तो आप सबके नाम एक के बाद एक छापोगे, पढ़ने में नहीं आएंगे। तो इसके बाद में इसको सी आउट लेस एंड एल कर दे, ठीक है, इस लूप के बाद। डू यू नाउ सी हाउ यू कैन एक्सट्रैक्ट थिंग्स? नाउ प्लीज रिमेंबर, इफ आई कैन प्रिंट आउट सर्टन कैरेक्टर्स इन एन एरे लाइक दिस, देन instead of saying C out, I can also say assign this to some other array. But you have to remember to manage the index of that array independently. Anyway, I think for today we have discussed some of these things which should have clarified how do you handle elements inside character. The trick is in setting up iterations, ordinary numerical computational iterations are straightforward. 1 टू n और उसके अंदर फिर 1 टू n, यानी n या n स्क्वायर या ऐसे इटरेशन होते हैं। एरेज जब स्ट्रिंग एरे हम कंसिडर करते हैं तो दो स्ट्रिंग एरेज हो सकती हैं, या एक स्ट्रिंग एरे में एसिंक्रोनसली किसी इंडेक्स को मूव करना है, किसी इसको मूव करना है। तो ऑलवेज रिमेंबर यू विल जनरली नॉट रिक्वायर नेस्टेड इटरेशन, एक ही इटरेशन से आप एरे स्कैन करेंगे, वो स्कैन करते करते या तो सिंबल पकड़ लें या पोजिशन पकड़ लें, स्टोर कर लें, और वहाँ से मूव करना है तो जहां तक मूव करना है उस पोजीशन को पकड़ के उसको आपको मूव कर सकते हैं, प्रिंट कर सकते हैं, कुछ भी कर सकते हैं। सो हैंडलिंग एरे स्ट्रिंग एलिमेंट्स विच कंटेन कैरेक्टर्स इज नॉट रियली डिफिकल्ट, इट इज एगोनाइजिंग, क्योंकि हमने अभी तक के जो भी इटरेशन देखे वो सब न्यूमरिकल इंडेक्सेस थे, न्यूमरिकल वैल्यूज थी, वो उसमें कैरेक्टर की पोजिशन वगैरह देखने का कोई सवाल नहीं था। सो इसमें शुरू में कन्फ्यूजन हो सकता है, बट वॉट हैपन्स मेनी टाइम्स आई हैव सीन मेनी ऑफ यू विल लूज कॉन्फिडेंस बिकॉज द कन्फ्यूजन, कि ये आई अलग से जा रहा है, जैसे आपने कहा वो जे मैं इटरेशन क्यों नहीं करूँ, क्योंकि न्यूमेरिकल एनालिसिस के सब प्रॉब्लम में हमने नेस्टेड इटरेशन देखा, लेकिन यहाँ पे जे का कोई अलग से इटरेशन नहीं है, ये हम खाली उसकी पोजिशन देख रहे हैं कहाँ क्या है और उसको स्टोर कर। सो इज दिस अंडरस्टूड नाउ? फाइन, I will be making some announcement regarding projects tomorrow, but the batch formation, I have had some issues, so I have shared that with some of the batch leaders. I wanted balanced batches in all the lab groups. So if you say lab batch 01, lab batch 02, then 5 teams which are to be formed, I have said that they should be balanced. I have found that some students are left out, they are not part of any group, any team. Is there anybody here who is not part of a team? Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4. This problem happens because if you have missed some lab turn and you are not physically present in the lab, then the people may not be able to assign, because an absent person is not counted generally. So I have given 2 more days, tomorrow and day after, by which time the team membership should be formed up. So discuss with your team leaders which batch or which particular team you would like to join. They will all have the names of all the people, set up some mechanism, but by Tuesday night the team membership should be decided. Tomorrow I'll discuss more about the project and then we'll get to know that.
The index file, how do you check if the end of the line is encountered? How is it being checked?
End of a line, actually in a text file, end of a line is written by \n. In a text file, yes, however you have given that \n, the \n will generally not reach your program, the function which reads the string will chew up that \n. If you are reading a text file, then you will not see \n coming into your program at all, the input function cin will eat up that \n. So you will never see a \n read using the normal input operation cin. However, there are input functions which will read every character from the string, no matter what character you have given. When we discuss that, you will see that \n will get in. In fact, one fundamental problem of string handling in, just one second, this is a very important point that he is making, although the whole class should know it, let you be the first one to know this. In a normal C or C++ string, if you have a character array, this will end with backslash L. This is the normal text line in C, C++. Any text line is terminated by backslash L. However, in Microsoft environment, the text line is not terminated just by a new line character. It is terminated by carriage return and line feed character. So that is called CRLF delimited character string. It has two characters at the end of every line. One is called carriage return, one is called line feed. The line feed is new line character. This wording comes from a typewriter. Have you seen a typewriter? Okay. जब टाइपराइटर पे आप टाइप करते हैं और लाइन खत्म हो जाती है तो क्या करते हैं आप एक बार रहता है उसको ऐसा करते हैं तो वो कागज आगे जाता है और फिर पूरा सिलेंडर यहाँ से वहाँ तक ले आते हैं तो वो बार आगे जाने को बोलते हैं लाइन फीड अपने लाइन आओ ऊपर कर और पूरा सिलेंडर वापस लाने को बोलते हैं कैरेज रिटर्न यानी कैरेज को आपने रिटर्न कर दिया तो इससे जो है वो आपका टाइपराइटर का पोजिशन पूरा पहले पोजिशन पर आ जाता है और अगले लाइन पर आ जाता है तो टाइपराइटर का सिम्बॉलिज्म जो है वो कैरेज रिटर्न लाइन फीड है और माइक्रोसॉफ्ट एनवायरनमेंट अपने सब स्ट्रिंग के आखिरी में कैरेज रिटर्न और लाइन फीड डालता है लेकिन यूनिक्स जो माइक्रोसॉफ्ट से बहुत पहले हुई उन्होंने कहा कि एक मुझे लाइन खत्म हुई कि नहीं न्यू लाइन काफी है अब इस न्यू लाइन वाले को डिस्प्ले कैसे करना आप टर्मिनल पे देखें या प्रिंटर पे देखें डिस्प्ले में खाली न्यू लाइन पे नहीं जाता है अगर न्यू लाइन पे जाएगा जैसे दीपक उसके बाद में आपने न्यू लाइन दे दिया तो फाटक यहां आ जाएगा उसके बाद में आपने न्यू लाइन दे दिया तो यहां आ जाए तो खाली न्यू लाइन पे नहीं जाना है आपको लाइन के न्यू लाइन के शुरुआत में जाना है तो आप जब एंड एल बोलते हैं सी आउट एंड एल सो एक्चुअली द सी प्लस प्लस प्रोग्राम नॉट ओनली पुट्स यू ऑन टू द न्यू लाइन इट ऑल्सो पुट्स यू एट द बिगिनिंग ऑफ द कैरेक्टर नाउ दिस सेपरेशन व्हाई आई इंडिकेट इफ यू हैव क्रिएटेड अ टेक्स्ट फाइल इन माइक्रोसॉफ्ट एनवायरमेंट इट विल हैव दिस If you have created a text file in Unix environment, it will have only this. It is fun to try and read a text file created in Unix environment using some Microsoft. It will look very gibberish or funny. So you have to open it in a word processor or word pad, which understands this properly. These are nuances because different people have written those programs and everybody has made one's own assumptions. Anyway, so this is just an interesting stuff I thought I'll tell you. So ordinarily you will not see new line inside your text, but we shall see functions which read all characters including new line characters.
How can I check if the line is being read? We have just ignored the characters from the text file.
Correct. When you use get line, oh you are reading characters one by one. Then you can actually test for backslash n. If backslash n has come, that means the line has ended. Oh, you are reading characters one by one. Okay, you are not reading get line or you are not reading individual string. If you are reading one character at a time, then backslash n will be a character. Righto, thank you very much.